And happy Mother's Day. Come on. Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day to all of the mothers out there and all of the mother figures. Thank you for the mother energy that all of you of any gender bring. We are all here on this planet sharing our love and positively influencing other human beings of all ages. So thank you, thank you, and thank you. This morning, Jeannie and Richard and the band and I, we are joined by all of this cuteness. Can you stand it? So you're in for a special treat this morning as they are part of our service in the beginning, not just part of it, we're really joining it and interacting. So we encourage you to just soak in the cuteness and the beauty and the joy of children. First, we are going to start off with the heart of the mother. So we encourage you to stand if you're able to join us in that. Open your hearts wherever you are and join us with, I am one with the heart of the mother.
Special treat. We all know that we all need our moms, no matter what age, or a mother figure, a mother energy. So some of our kids are going to recite a poem for you. And Mr. Carter, you're first.
When you thought I wasn't looking, I saw you put my painting on the refrigerator, and I wanted to paint another one.
When you thought I wasn't looking, I heard you say a prayer, and I believe that there was a God to talk to.
When you thought I wasn't looking, you fed a stray cat, and I thought it was good to be nice to animals.
When you thought I wasn't looking, I saw you make my favorite cake for me, and I knew that little things are special things.
When you thought I wasn't looking, I saw tears come from your eyes, and I learned that sometimes things hurt, but it's all right to cry.
When you thought I wasn't looking, I saw how proud you were, and I wanted to be everything that I could be.
When you thought I wasn't looking, you slipped a $100 bill into my jacket pocket, and it made the end of the month a heck of a lot easier.
Thank you. So we know that we all need our moms, that mother energy, that father energy, that grandmother and grandfather energy, no matter how old we are, right? And we see the face of God wherever we look. Is that right, congregation? All right, so on your feet, if you're able, we're going to sing Face of God, and the kids are going to lead us in the motions. Come down there with me.
And the final line of our poem is, when you thought I wasn't looking, I looked. And I wanted to say thanks for all the things I saw when you thought I wasn't looking. Please join us in singing, "You Are the Face of God." Please join us in the hand motions as well.
How about a hand for our youngest congregants and sage wisdom? So Miss Lisa's gonna, we're gonna go downstairs and do some fun things, but we wanna say Happy Mother's Day to everybody. All right, I'm gonna welcome the newcomers. You can go with Miss Lisa, except for Karma, and a couple people are gonna help me. Okay, go on with Miss Lisa. Good job, Carter. Good, yeah, give him a hand. Go on, Andy. Go ahead, everybody, go with Miss Lisa. They want to, yeah, now the theater bugs bit them, huh?
If only we could get the adults to want to stay in the sanctuary that long. Lock the doors.
Okay.
I'm just kidding. I'm giving you a bad time.
I've got a couple special helpers because we want to welcome anyone who is here for the very first time. We are just so grateful that you decided to spend your Sunday, your Mother's Day with us. And so we're not going to ask you to testify. We're not going to ask you to get up and dance. We might someday, but not today. But if you are here, we just want you to feel welcome, like you've stepped into a new home. Up there you see a number. If you text new to that phone number, it'll put you in our system and we'll send you just a little bit of information. We don't inundate you, but it gives you lots of ideas about the things that are going on in our congregation. So you can text new to that number. But for now, the kids have a special treat. Can you bring us those flowers? We're going to hand out flowers today. What? We're going to hand out flowers today. Anybody who is here for the first time, raise your hand, and we want to bring you a flower. And if there aren't that many, we may bring some flowers. There we go. We have some new people there. All right. Go, Karma. Anybody else? New? Keep your hand raised. All right. Get some flowers from Karma. Go get some flowers from Karma. Keep your hands up. They're a little bit, you know, new to this. Anybody else new? Over here. Come on, guys. Come on, Olivia. Come with me. I know it takes a little longer, but who doesn't want a flower from a child? Come on, Olivia. Come with me.
All right. Say welcome to our
home. Thank you.
Welcome to our family. Welcome to our community, and welcome to our heart space. We welcome you into and behold the light of the world that you are. We welcome the gift that you have brought into this space, and we hope that your being here is also a gift to you. At that exchange, something beautiful happens. We remember we belong to each other. I hope that you will, if you have any questions about what Unity North is all about, that you'll see me in the foyer right after the service. But right now, Danielle's going to tell you a little bit about the major wonderful things that are going on here in our community.
And these wonderful things are such a gift to all of us. Today, we start with our first gift announcement. The LGBTQ plus ministry is having a lunch gathering today. It will be outside and in the labyrinth. So if you identify as LGBTQ, if you're an ally or a friend, this lunch is for you. Also, we have a brick project going on. There's lots of details on our website, so be sure to check out Facebook or our website for more information. But if you haven't ordered your brick and you're wondering, what is she talking about? Go to our website, find out more information, and get your brick order today. We also, although there are so many amazing things going on, there's room for more amazing things. So starting this Tuesday, the Spanish ministry will be having meditation in the Peace Chapel. So Tuesdays Wednesdays at 6:30 p.m. in the Peace Chapel, the Spanish ministry will be hosting meditation. So that's a beautiful thing. Meditation in any language is just a wonderful thing to do and have in your life. So we hope to see you there. Our Spanish service is on the third Sunday of the month. And last but not least, we have Bob Sima back in the house on May 29th. So I know there's a lot of excited faces about that. So Bob Sima in concert, May 29th at 6:30, also in the Peace Chapel. There is no cost to get in the door. There is a love offering to help support that ministry. So we hope to see you there. Make sure, if I went too fast, there's a website, there's Facebook, more information on all of those things. But I have to tell you about another gift that we have here at Unity North, and that is the beauty of spirit and voice of Tommy Berry, who is back in the house bringing us a lovely song. Give it up for Tommy Berry.
Thank you, Danielle. Good morning, Unity North. Happy Mother's Day. And this song we're dedicating to the mothers and aunties and grandmothers and nieces who have transitioned. So,
I took the supermarket flowers from the windowsill. I threw the day-old tea from the cup. Packed up the photo album Matthew had made, memories of a life that's been loved. Took the get well soon cards and stuffed animals. Poured the old ginger beer down the sink. Dad always told me, don't you cry when you're down. But Mom, there's a tear every time that I blink. Oh, I'm in pieces, it's tearing me up, but I know a heart that's broke is a heart that's been loved. So I'll sing hallelujah. You were an angel in the shape of my mom. When I fell down, you'd be there holding me up. Spread your wings as you go. When God takes you back, he'll say hallelujah. Fluffed the pillows, made the bed, stacked the chairs up, folded your nightgowns neatly in a case. John said he'd drive, then put his hand on my cheek and wiped a tear from the side of my face. Oh, I hope the world can see the world as you did. And I know a life with love is a life that's been lived. So I'll sing hallelujah. You were an angel in the shape of my mom. When I felt holding me up, spread your wings as you go. And when God takes you back, we'll say hallelujah, you're home. Person I have become. Spread your wings when you go, and when God takes you back, she'll say hallelujah, welcome home.
peace tonight.
Thank you, Tommy. I don't know who put together the order of service that had that happen before I had to get up and speak. I know that Tommy's mom is struggling with health concerns. My mom is struggling with health concerns, and I saw the tears around the room as you sang hallelujah, saying goodbye to someone. Mother's Day, as you can see, is one of the toughest of the Sundays during the year because of that very reason. I have the opportunity to spend a lot of time with my colleagues, both in the interfaith community and in the New Thought community. And I think that no service and no talk is more dreaded or feared than the talk that comes every year annually on Mother's Day. What do you say? It is difficult. If you just talk about the sweet, warm, loving part of mothers, you hit a certain part of the congregation that feels really good about it and loves it. And then you've got the other half of the congregation that says, it hurts. And it cuts to the core, and it's painful, and it's difficult. So then if you talk about the mom issues, the difficulties of being a mom or having a mother, and by the way, show of hands, who had a mother here? Yeah, there's mom issues, always going to be present in the room. If you only address those parts of it, then guess what? The ones that had the perfect mother are upset because you didn't just acknowledge that I have the good mother. And then there are those of us who had mothers that, you know, maybe weren't too excited about being a mother. And those in the room who long to be a mother that couldn't have a child. We honor all of it today. All the emotions are welcome here. Breathe that in. You know, when we look at the spiritual masters, I wanted to just point this out. I'm going to give a little history today, but I wanted to start with this. This Krishna and Buddha. How many of you know that Krishna and Buddha were raised by foster parents? Foster mothers. How many knew that Buddha and Muhammad both lost their mothers to death very early on in their childhood? Of course, then there's the painful remembrance that Mary watched her son die. We're supposed to outlive our children, yes? So then the tears come. And let the tears flow today. It's all a part of it. Then there's the mother of the founder of the Sikh religion. Some people say Sikh. It's actually pronounced Sikh. It's a Sikh religion. Guru Nanak, forgive me if I'm mispronouncing that, his mother was forever frustrated by him. He was a rebellious young man who wanted to challenge the religious systems of the time, the caste system of greater than and less than, which is kind of what we do here. But his mother was forever frustrated. How many frustrated mothers that your kids, not just your sons, didn't show up the way you thought they should have shown up? Oh, let's get real and let's get honest. They have a mind of their own, and that makes it really challenging to talk about what Mother's Day is, because it means something completely different to each and every one of us. But I will tell you what it means to the mother that's sitting on the stage. Madeline Rosales is our chaplain on duty today. It's her first time to sit in that chair. She is holding a mother consciousness for you. And she's joined by the mother known as Atiba Davis on the other side of the room, the unbroken awareness of the presence of God. Can it be that we join them in truth and in consciousness, that no matter the experience of motherhood, no matter the experience of mama, good, bad, or otherwise, that we can hold the unbroken awareness of the presence of God through it all? And we can honor the divine mother in, through, around, and expressed as all creation. Yes? Today we're going to talk about the divine mother, and we're going to talk a little bit about the divine masculine as well. So men, get ready. But I thought I'd start with something humorous before I got into a little history. I'm going to set the preacher on the side for the day. The preacher will be back next week, don't worry, he'll be back. But I want to be more of a historian today. But I thought I'd start with a foundation of a little bit of laughter. A little girl asked her mother, "How did the human race appear on earth?" And the mother answers, "God made Adam and Eve, and they had children, and God made all of the children." 2 days later, the little girl went to ask her father the same question. And dad answered this, "Well, many years ago, there were monkeys, and we developed from the monkeys. The human race came from apes." The confused little girl went back to her mother a couple of days later and said, "Mom, how is it possible that you told me that the human race was created by God, And Dad said they developed from monkeys. The mother answered, "Well, dear, it's quite simple. I told you about my side of the family, and your father told you about his side of the family." You know, sometimes when you look at the masculine-feminine balance of the world, we think, yeah, we can tell who came from the animals and who behaves like an animal. And I want to talk about the consciousness of mother and motherhood and Mother's Day today, which may be completely different than anything you've ever heard before. There's two stories of Mother's Day, and I want to get into the history today a little bit. Julia Ward Howe was born in 1819. How many have ever heard the name Julia Ward Howe? She's attributed with being the founder of Mother's Day. I think you might think twice about that. Two ladies I'm going to share about today, their pictures are up on the screen, Julia Ward Howe and Anna Marie Jarvis. But Julia Ward Howe was born in 1819 in New York City to a family of wealth, to a family of privilege and comfort. Yet she, like Nanook, Guru Nanook, had a very rebellious nature as well. And she stood up to the authority of the ruling religion. She stood up to the authority of the male-dominated landscape. At her time, that was quite a feat for a woman to stand in her power. She had a rebellious spiritual streak and, in fact, studied many of the founders of the New Thought religion. Ralph Waldo Emerson, Henry David Thoreau. She was involved in transcendental meditation. Oh my God, what is the woman doing? During the Civil War, she was involved in what was called the Sanitary Commission. Anybody know what the Sanitary Commission became? Anybody? That was the original name of the Red Cross. This woman had a heart of service. She had a heart of compassion, and she had a heart of love, and she wanted to give it to the world and refused to play small in a male-dominated society. She had a heart of love, and she made it her work to tend those that were wounded in the Civil War, those both physically wounded and psychologically wounded. She had a psychological degree, and she tended the wounds that sometimes you can't see on the outside, but boy, do they go deep. She saw firsthand the ravages of war, which caused her to become an avid peace activist. Hell hath no fury like a woman with a purpose and a desire who will not play small and not be subjugated and not be put down. I love you, Mom. No. She saw firsthand the ravages of war, which caused her to become a peace activist. In 1870, there was an international peace conference that was going to be held in London, England. And Julia wrote to the organizers of this peace conference. Of course, they were all men. She had written a proclamation that she wanted read at this peace conference. And the men, of course, peace on earth is a wonderful idea, but it will be brought about by men. And they refused her a platform. They refused her even access into the peace conference. The men will handle it. Well, this is how that worked. Not so well if you look at the world today. They blocked her from attending and being a woman of power and a woman of strength and a woman with means. She rented her own boat to get to London, England. And she went over there and she rented her own hall and said, "My voice will not be put down. My voice will be heard." And she issued her proclamation. And this is in part what she had in that proclamation. I'm going to invite you to read it with me together today. Next slide, please. Together. "Arise, all women who have hearts. Our husbands will not come to us reeking of carnage for our applause. Our sons will not be taken from us to unlearn all we have taught them of charity, mercy, and patience. We, the women of one country, will not have those of another country allow our sons to be trained to injure theirs. Disarm, disarm," and she actually put it three times, say it again, "disarm." This woman had courage. This woman had guts. And Julia Ward Howe must live in us on this Mother's Day. We must channel the same strength and courage and not play small to authorities that would put us down and keep us silent. The world is at war. Oh, and it may look like bombs and tanks in Ukraine, but there's a war going on in our own nation. There's a war going on in our own church. There's a war going on in our families. There's wars going on within us right now. The time has come for the new age to emerge within us, the age of Aquarius. We're leaving the Piscean age, which is a male-dominated mindset. And we must channel the divine feminine in all of us, not just the women in the room, but the men who also have a divine feminine. The time has come to disarm and let the cycle of a softer approach, love and strength as partners. She issued this proclamation on June 2nd, 1870, and she called for an international Mother's Day of Peace, which she envisioned as an annual international peace festival. A little different than what we do today on Mother's Day, isn't it? Looks a little different. Mother's Day was observed in many places on June 2nd as a day of peace, led by mothers who had enough courage and enough strength to stand up against the violence of a male-driven society. The intention of Mother's Day was a rebellion. A rebellion against violence, and it was a call for peace. Maybe we can take Julia Ward Howe, because she lives in the cells of our being, and find that courage on Mother's Day and become peace advocates. And maybe worry less about what kinds of flowers are given, or what kind of Hallmark card you paid $12 for, or whether you did it right or didn't do it right, or whether your mother did it right or did it wrong, or whether you failed as a mother or did well. And maybe this is a day of peace. This is a day to pick up the phone and offer forgiveness. This is the day to remember that we're all doing the best we can, and that maybe our mothers did the best we can, and we can lead a rebellion that peace is more powerful than our disagreements. Peace is more powerful than our hurts. Peace is more powerful than our wounds. Story number two, a woman named Anna Marie Jarvis. You probably have never heard of her name. It's actually two women, Anna Marie Jarvis and her daughter, who finished her legacy. Today, I want to honor the legacy of what has been passed down from grandmother to daughter, from daughter to child, from child to us, from us to the world. We'll start with the mom. Anna Marie Jarvis grew up in the Appalachian Mountains of Virginia. She lived roughly at the same time as Julia Ward Howe, but geographically and certainly, if you know the Appalachian Mountains, economically, way different. She didn't have the ability to rent a boat and to rent a hall in London, England. That did not stop her. Their purpose was single, which was found in the roots and a desire to serve each other, to serve humanity, and to create peace. She was concerned about the health and the safety conditions in Appalachia, which is still a problem that we have here today. And she organized what she called Mother's Day Work Clubs that raised money for medicine and to hire women to help out families whose mothers had developed tuberculosis. That was basically a death sentence during this time. And she developed an organization that became Foster Mother for Families, much like Krishna and Buddha had. Her efforts also provided for the inspection of food to keep the children safe. You see, Anna Marie Jarvis lost four children to disease. She had 12, but she lost four of them. And she used the pain of what was in motherhood to reach out to the community in a greater way, to be a greater advocate to heal and to help and to support and to love. So you may be sitting here today with very painful memories of mom or grandma or dad or grandpa. Could it be that your pain could be used as a springboard to a greater expression of love and a greater expression of peace? I say you're going to honor these two women if you say yes. And if you don't, you have wasted your God-given ability to make a difference on the planet. Be the mother of a new paradigm. Be the mother of a new reality. Be the one that causes the change on the planet, even in the midst of your pain. Having lost 4 of her 12 children, she did exactly that. Sometimes our greatest passions come from our deepest pain. When the Civil War broke out, Anna Marie Jarvis's life was dramatically shaped by the conflict and the difficulties. The area where she lived in Virginia, the Appalachian Mountains of Virginia, that particular area leaned very heavily to the side of anti-slavery. And so that part of Appalachia seceded from the Confederate States and went over to the Union Army, later to become West Virginia. Now, I understand that there are those in Virginia that still don't recognize West Virginia. For some people, there's still a war going on. And if you look at humanity today, maybe there is still a war going on that's even bigger than the Civil War. But the Civil Rights Movement is not done and dead. It's needed today. Well, what happened at the end of that war, all the soldiers began to come back to Appalachia. All the soldiers were coming back. Brothers who had fought on either side of that war. When they came back, there was tension. Can you imagine the tension? Anybody ever been in a family when you show up at a family gathering, and the last family gathering, you were on separate sides of an argument and a debate? You don't have that in your family. Oh, let me tell you, the last 6 years has been one family debate after another. Maybe not as tragic as a civil war, but the cause of peace was absolutely as present as it ever was. She decided to do something about that tension, and she organized a Mother's Friendship Day. The objective was to bring soldiers together into a circle who had fought on opposite sides of the Civil War. Anybody ever have a grandmother or a mother who used to grab you by the ear? I can just picture this woman in her strength, in her courage, in her toughness, grabbing a young boy who fought on the Confederate side and a young boy who fought on the Union side and pulled their ears and said, make nice, make friends. Mothers tend to do that. Let me tell you, my dad could say something 100 times till he was blue in the face, but if mom said it, you better listen. And grandma used to grab your ear, and I don't know, I used to get beat up. It didn't hurt nearly as much as your mother grabbing your ear. And you paid attention. She grabbed the ears of soldiers on both sides and said, sit down at the table and make peace. Sit down at the table and remember that you belong to each other. That's what we do here. That's what we do here. Every single week is carry that. We don't grab you by the ears, but the minister has a tendency to get in your face and meddle a little bit. The Divine Mother is asking for unity and oneness to come together. Unity in diversity. Many people in Appalachia absolutely feared this is going to be a disaster. It's not going to work. But the event was a huge success. Mother's Friendship Day became an annual event in Appalachia. Very small. Just as it was for Julia Ward Howe, Anna Marie Jarvis invoked the name Mother's Day. Mother's Day as a way of promoting peace, as a way of promoting reconciliation, a way of promoting unity. 2 years after Anna Marie Jarvis died in 1905, her daughter of the same name began a crusade for an official nationally recognized Mother's Day. And believe me, she had to fight a male-dominated Congress. But she did not give up the fight. Today, I want to honor on Mother's Day that divine ideas do not die, but grandmother passes them to mother. Mother passes them to daughter, and daughter waves the banner and waves it hard and waves it high. I will not be put down. Sometimes generational healing lands in your lap. Sometimes generational power lands in your lap, and we as daughters and sons of grandparents need to wave the banner really, really high today. That's what Mother's Day is about. Quit worrying about the right card and the right flowers and start honoring the legacy of the powerful women that brought you onto the planet and to pay the divine idea forward. take the courage and the strength and pay it forward. After 6 years, six long years of petitioning a male-dominated Congress, President Woodrow Wilson signed a congressional proclamation declaring Mother's Day as an official holiday to be celebrated on the second Sunday of May, where we sit today. Mrs. Howe and Mrs. Jarvis never met, but their stories contain the same energy of power, of persistence, of possibility, and of peace. Mother's Day, far from being the sentimental holiday dominated by Hallmark moments that cost us $12 for a card, it's far from what it has become today. And in fact, Anna Jarvis, the daughter, wrote at one point when she saw what had happened to her mom's legacy, once again, channeled the divine idea of strength and power, and this is what she had to say. Together, to have Mother's Day, the burdensome, wasteful, expensive gift day that Christmas and other special days have become, is not our pleasure. If the American people are not willing to protect Mother's Day from the hordes of money schemers that would overwhelm it with their schemes, then we shall cease having a Mother's Day. Wow, that's in your face a little bit. So we come together or don't come together, many people staying at home because Mother's Day is just too painful. Mother's Day is just too difficult. Or Mother's Day at the church, they're going to talk about something other than my perfect mother. Maybe we can let go of those things. And remember what Mother's Day is all about. It is about peace. It is about reconciliation. It is about forgiveness. It is about grabbing our internal self by the ear and said, knock it off. Not on my watch. And if we think it's just in Ukraine, or it's just in the House of Representatives and the Congress, then we have missed the boat. Grab your own ear and bring yourself home to the fact that we belong to each other on different sides of an aisle, on different sides of religious belief systems, on different experiences of mother, good, bad, and otherwise. Drag yourself into the community and say, we're making a difference as mothers of a new reality, as mothers of a new paradigm. One mother of wealth, Julia Ward Howe, and one mother of opportunity, and another of meager means and very little education. But both, with the guts, determination, and vision, had a mother's heart that stood up to the mindset of war and said, no more, not on my watch. How many of us have ever, I think of Julia Marie Jarvis, who did not let her lack of money or her lack of education get in the way of making the difference. And I look at the two stories, Mother's Day, the second Sunday of May. It wasn't the wealth that got it. It was the consciousness that got it in the middle of Appalachia in poor country during the Civil War. Both of these mothers had children, and we celebrate that today. Many mothers have kids sitting here today, and I celebrate that with you today. God bless you. I celebrate my own mother. In the midst of her trial and struggle, she's still doing whatever she can to keep her family together. Thank God, because my dad would be a pile of mess without her as she lays on the couch trying to cure herself of cancer and a broken back. Yet she's still the spine of the family. I don't know how she pulls it off, but I hope there's a little bit of my mom's blood in me, that I've got the kind of courage in my pain to use my pain as a catalyst to make the world a better place. That's what Mother's Day is about. To use my own pain as a means of creating a greater peace on the planet. To create a paradigm of social justice and peace and reconciliation and the end to war. The wars out here and the wars in here. It's a paradigm shift. I'm going to invite the band to come back up. It's a paradigm. They're not even in the room. Where'd they go? They're all outside calling their mothers. They're used to the preacher being up here. The preacher usually goes to about 12:10. But the historian's going to end at 12 o'clock and get into the meditation. Maybe if enough of us have the same kind of passion and courage, we can mother new realities. I would be really remiss if I did not mention the Civil War and mothers, and just mention two white mothers. A lot of the history of black mothers right there in the middle of the midst of Civil War, but got written out, got written away. We don't want to look at it. We need to look at it. And there's a mother who was one of my heroes in the midst of the Civil War, who was raised in slavery, Sojourner Truth. This is what, and it's on the surface, what she said is funny and a bit amusing. But you dig beneath the surface, what Sojourner Truth did is have the same courage and maybe more than the white faces that stood up for peace, that stood up for a different reality and a different paradigm. This is what Sojourner Truth had to say. Let's read it together. If the first woman God ever made was strong enough to turn the world upside down, these women together ought to be able to turn it right again. That's truth. If somebody, a mother with many children, during the Civil War, after the Civil War, when they were supposedly given their freedom and still had to fight for many, many, many years, and we're still fighting Sojourner Truth's quest for freedom for her children and her grandchildren, maybe we can turn it right again. On Mother's Day, get a nice card, get some pretty flowers, but for God's sake, don't waste the energy and the courage of Sojourner Truth, Julia Ward Howe, and Anna Marie Jarvis by just tossing it away as a simple gesture of gratitude. It's way more than that. I've been called a mother, by the way. I've been called a mother. I want to be a mother. I want to be a mother, and I want to be in your face. I want to be a minister that says, we're not going to play small here. We're not going to have a nice little Mother's Day, miss the people that was too painful to come here today. Those of you online, maybe you're watching. I'm challenging you to be as strong as these three women, and to not let any adversity get in the way, any limitation get in the way of you being the ambassador, the emissary, the testimony, and the mother of peace. We're going to go into a time of meditation, and I invite you to take all three of the women that I have mentioned in this talk and to let them live in you. We have a very special treat. A mother and a daughter are going to sing us and invite you into a song that we chose specifically for today. I invite you to be the mother of a new reality as they bring in a new reality for each other. This is Avril and Clementine. Mother to mother, grandmother to mother, mother to child. Let's be part of the legacy. Regardless of the color of your skin, regardless of your experience of mother, I invite you to take somebody into your heart right now, as we enter the meditation, to take those words and to sing it to that person, maybe that person that you've kept at bay, maybe the person that treated you wrongly, Maybe the person that didn't show up, whether it be a child or a mother, the way you thought, let's be the legacy of peace and grab ourselves by the ear and know that love and peace is more powerful than any of it. I invite you to sing these words with us.
How could anyone ever tell you you are anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you are less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your love
I invite you to close your outer eyes. I invite you to fit tall and well. I invite you to let the chair support you. Relax yourself deeply into the chair.
You're aware of your body and aware of the ability to move your body, but that you're not using that ability at this time. Be aware of stillness. Begin to attend to your breath, taking some long, slow, full breaths. Maybe this is the first time you're elevating the breath in your consciousness all day or all week. Every breath is a prayer, a song of another moment of existence. In your mind's eye, visualize the face of the divine as the universe, the cosmos, the most divine incarnation of mother energy, giving birth to all of creation. However which way you visualize this is correct. You cannot do this wrong. Maybe you see galaxies swirling, nebula expanding. Maybe you just see space. But understand, know, feel in your heart, this is mother energy. Then continuing to sit tall and well, breathing attentively. Now, visualize the divine as Mother Earth. Maybe in the indigenous traditions as Pachamama or Gaia, sustaining us, providing food, shelter, warmth, home. See the divine in this form of Mother. Again, this is the face of God. Continue to let the chair hold you. Let your spine extend. Breathe. Body in stillness. Now see the divine as a divine goddess of compassion. Perhaps Green Tara, Mother Mary, Oshun, nurturing, loving, teaching us gentleness and patience. Breathe and behold this face of the divine. Then finally, recall in your mind's eye your own mother or a mother role model. A teacher, an aunt, a beloved leader, but someone who taught you to care, who cared for you, all of these images, all of these forms, bring them into your heart. They are all love. Remain in that space. Mother as love.
Be aware of the silence at the center of consciousness. Be aware of the relative quietness of your mind. Be aware of the smoothness of your breath, of the stillness of your body. Then gently open your eyes.
You know, we don't typically applaud for a meditation, but I think that what this mom and daughter did was absolutely beautiful. Thank you, guys. You know, we started the talk today with male energy, and Dad said, "Oh, we came from monkeys," and the mom energy said, "We came from God." And the answer is yes, we did. Fully human, fully divine, all at the same time. Let strength and compassion be partners as we change the face of the planet. One act of rebellion at a time. We're going to go into our time of offering, and I'm going to ask Danielle to come up and take the offering today.
We're at that time in the service, that beautiful time, also that joyful time where we get to give back. We were poured into so richly and so deeply today on so many facets. And we know that there are so many ways to give back, and our offering is one of them. We can do so physically in a basket in the back, or we can do so virtually by texting. And it magically appears by texting Unity North and the amount that you'd like to give to 73256. It's so simple. It's so simple, I promise. If you haven't done it yet, once you do it, you will keep doing it because it's so easy. And if you've done it, you're probably in the midst of it and you might already be done. So thank you in advance for the love that you're giving to us as we continue to pour into you and build that rich community. And in that spirit of continuing to build community, we invite Tommy Berry back to the mic with Forever Young. So may your heart stay forever young as you listen to this song.
And this is a happy song. Feel free to sing along if you know the words.
Be brave, and in my heart you'll always
you so, so very much. But before we close, I'm going to invite you to stand. We're not going to hold hands, but you go ahead and stand. We had a special treat. You know, the role of a parent and a biological child can be tense. A mother and a daughter, it can be tense. But I am a stepfather. I have no biological children, but I have 15 grandchildren as a stepfather. And when a young girl comes up and says, I want to offer something as a stepdaughter to a stepmother, I think it's important. This is Sophia, who is a part of the family that Clementine and Avril are a part of. And she said, I want to share something as we close. So, Sophia, it is all yours.
Hello, my name is Sophia, and I am part of the...
Hold it close.
I am Avril and John's daughter. And I just wanted to say, since it's Mother's Day, I wanted to say that Avril is a very, very special part of me. She has been with me for over 2 years, and Clementine is another part of my heart. And as I was sitting through this service, I just thought that I would come up and say thank you, and that thank you for all everything that's, you know, happened for the past 2 years. I love you guys.
And of course, there were those in that family that say they owe it all to Grandma Yvonne. Yvonne is the reason you're the rock behind it all anyway. But anyway, let's take a stand as we go forth on our different ways today on this Mother's Day. Let's channel every name that has been mentioned here today, every divine idea that's been mentioned here today, and let's be a stand for peace. Let's be a stand for love. Let's be a stand for love. Let there be peace.
I am a stand for peace. Let there be let there be love. I am a stand for love. Let there be joy. I am a stand for joy. We are making a new world.
We are making a new world.
We are making a new world now.
Raise them up.
We are making a new world now.
Happy Mother's Day to each and every one of you. Go be the peace that we know you to be. Have a blessed day. On duty, Achiba in the corner, and Madeline up here. They'd love to pray with you.